Hello, and thank you for watching another Lombardi Live. You know, I often start these out by saying, this is a very special show, and I do that because I feel they are very special shows. This particular one is really personal to me. It has to do with reflecting on the days when I used to study with Freddie Gruber. And a lot of what we talked about in those days was him breaking down Buddy Rich's technique. As Freddie explained it to me, Buddy was motivating and following the bounce of the stick, doing nuances or even some major things a little bit different than most other drummers. For years, I studied with him. I actually even rented a house behind him at one point because, as you've heard many stories about Freddie being disorganized, they're all true, by the way. I would show up at 3 o'clock for my lesson and he hadn't started his 1 or 2 o'clock student yet. So renting the little house behind him as kind of a crash pad was really a great decision because I got to spend hours with Freddie, not only talking about drummers and technique, but specifically talking about his experiences when he was in New York growing up with Buddy Rich and how Freddie interpreted Buddy's technique. We're going to be coming out with a step-by-step course early next year. I didn't want to put this video up quite this early, but I decided to do it because I didn't want to confuse you. It's not a lesson, it's kind of a mini documentary. If you were to see a video of a professional tennis player serving, you wouldn't take that and go home and learn how to do it by just looking at him doing it. You would have an instructor who would break it down step by step. This is kind of you looking at what Buddy's doing, and then step by step, later we'll go through a course and break that down, lesson exercise by exercise, as Freddie broke it down for me. We're going to talk about the inside release in this video a little bit. Again, that's one of the unique things Buddy did, not something that I would expect that you would try and put into your playing right away. We are also going to be talking about being relaxed, however. That is something that I do want you to put into your playing and your practice time right now. You need to be as relaxed as you possibly can. Here's Freddie and I looking at Buddy and talking about his technique, how he uses his body to follow and motivate the bounce of the stick. I think you're going to find it really interesting.
Sitting here making me feel like a student again, I wanted to talk about some of the things that you brought up that I think are really important for the young drummers to think about today. And I'll, you know, go through some of the things that I remember like we were sitting there and it was yesterday. And, you know, and it was the first lesson, and want to watch a few of Buddy's clips too. But I'll kind of paraphrase it. But I remember you said, you know, what I think the question you asked is what would happen if the stick hit the drum and you let go of it immediately? And my answer, as is every drummer who I've asked that question to's answer, is that the stick would come back up, fly back up in the air. And you brought up, I think, a life-changing answer to that, which is different, which is that no, the stick would go underneath the pad, would go under the drum. And I remember you said that's something that Buddy understood.
Not only the relief of a stick coming up, which is if you're not on the object and there's no impact, but for you to go below the object's point of impact, you know, that way, which automatically would bring the front end up, so to be between the two points, you could play games with the up and down. And it was just one of the very many things that I saw that you could do with a drumstick to make it a little more pliable, you know, so it isn't just ta-ta, up, down, up, down. So, you know, you have some looseness to move around.
The exercises we used to do, and I brought some of the books that you used to teach out of. In fact, this is my book when we studied.
My God almighty.
Burns and Mallon, when it was...
the finger control?
When it was $2, right? Where you wrote, you used this kind of as a benchmark to write week-by-week lessons, basically. You would date it right going down the line. The exercises in the book are... don't teach you anything,
note.
Or just, yeah, they're just teaching your quarter notes, but it's the way you had to go through each one of these pages with dead stick exercises, fingers up, fingers down, open, closed, under the drum.
I got more out of that one page. I mean, we must have done that 500 different ways, you know what I mean?
We would spend quite a bit of time looking at just going, the idea
yeah.
of following
yeah,
the
yeah,
bounce
yeah,
of the
yeah,
stick
yeah,
going
yeah.
under the drum. And I believe you call that an inside release, which to me is the difference between the outside release, which is kind of more known as the molar method, and what Buddy did, which is a unique way of combining those two, as you used to explain it.
Yeah.
And let
The interplay.
Interplay, right.
Yeah, between, you know, the surface, the surface of the object you're playing on, which is, you can do with a drumstick as opposed to a tap shoe, because once you're standing and those taps are on the floor, you can't go below the floor. You know? Whereas with a drum, you could go into the space below toward the floor, you know, so it was pliable.
Just to mention, I think, is the second you go down, the tip of the stick is up.
When you go down, it automatically
comes up.
Yeah, unless you let go of the stick.
Right, right. Do that for me for a second.
Well, I don't even know these days, you know, it's a little like fool around. But I mean, if I would just push my hand, because there's no floor over here.
Right, right.
I got nothing but space. So if I go, here's the floor, but it doesn't extend out, so if I'm going below it, okay, now you got a vertical stick, and all I have to do is just come up a little, and it'll stay in time.
So you've got the stick, the stick is up. This is ahead of the back already.
Yeah, and it's on its way.
It's all the way up, right.
It's on its way. I mean, there's a mathematical thing there, I mean, because there's an arc.
The idea of going under the drum is you play faster to be creative. It's because it's under the plane of the drum, not necessarily the drum itself. You can create by just raising the elbow and bringing the elbow out a little bit further. Then I can go under the drum right here without having anything to do with actually where the drum is.
Taking this and looking at Buddy's playing and slow motioning it, even taking the cymbal rhythm as an example, am I correct in thinking that most players are going to go, I guess what you would call left to right, and come out this way where he goes the other direction? Let's take a look at this for a second, because there's a shot that we can get here of just playing the cymbal rhythm on Love for Sale, opening up the song.
Well, he's going below the shell of the drum. Well, you know, down below, that brings the front end of the stick up.
The same thing you were just explaining here.
Yeah. Watch him, he'll go below and from right to left. You see, he's going below the shell. He's got it this way. Below the shell.
If we go frame by frame there, yeah.
Here, you hear, in effect, there, watch this. Just do this. You know what he's doing? Now watch the stick. In effect, it isn't a stroke. Mm-hmm. It's this. You know? That's what that is. It isn't bang, bang.
Which I used to say, this, it makes the stick look like it's not straight. Looks like it is
rubbery
and bending.
There's the enigma of the universe. I mean, you know.
So you see it right? I mean, you see, after the point that it hits, you see where it continues down. Right there is what you're talking about.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We'll be right back.
check out his left hand, because this is something that's just bizarre to me at this point. This is the slow motion version.
He's in a dead stick stroke when he strikes the drum.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, you know, he's like, you know, there you are at the level of the floor. You're right at the level. It's the impact factor. It's not.
But it looks to me like the shuffle pattern, most drummers would play the shuffle and play the accent as they come down, and he's the other way.
No.
He's playing it
up.
Up. And that's the same thing you're talking about. He's getting the accent as he goes under, and it's back up again instantly?
Because he automatically knows down is easy. It's this. Up and Z. Are you listening?
Come up.
Yeah, you know, I mean, the down factor is built in. If you could just harness, you know, not knocking it out of time, you know. So there's some kind of harmonic between you and the stick, you know.
And that, the concept of him doing that, have you seen any other drummer actually apply that approach in their playing?
Not quite like Buddy is in touch with motion, how things move.
Yeah.
You know, he's very much in touch. And more than that, he is pliable enough to respond to what those built-in rules already are, they're there. He didn't manufacture that.
I remember you reaching out one point and putting two fingers under my arm.
Yeah.
You used to do that a lot, remember that?
Yeah, just go saying, ahead and
saying,
then...
Say relax. You used to say relax, you know.
And then take that, and it should fall.
Yeah, you're not relaxed. And that was like, could you actually be that relaxed in play? And you're like, yeah, this part of your arm isn't holding up. There's a contradiction there.
If you couldn't be that relaxed, let alone not to dismiss playing, but not talking about playing, if you couldn't be that relaxed, it would mean that most of the time you'd be walking around with your arm up, but you don't think about it when it just falls. It just falls.
And he is that relaxed.
He's getting in line with what's already there. He's just making it work within the confines of the space that he wants to occupy.
So what you're saying is you could, and he apparently is, the way he's utilizing that space and time, allowing himself to, one, be very relaxed.
He is very relaxed,
yeah. To the point to where the rebound of the stick, because there's certainly a natural amount of rebound going on.
Especially if it hits an object that don't move. Right. Something has got to move.
So can you be so relaxed that your wrists are actually rebounding with the stick?
They could if you follow the stick at the same rate of speed that the stick is going to rebound, that you're really just a housing. It's just passing through and you're following it and not obstructing it.
But really, this... When you put your two fingers under there again, okay, now...
Ay, had a lot of weight.
That's right, but that's not. Now, I'm take it away now, and I'll be holding it up. Any drummer I've done that with, you take it away, and it always stays up. Because I think there's a thought that you have to do something. You have to make something happen. You have to work. And you're kind of saying that the work is done when you become a human being. Just let it go.
Flow.
Let it work for itself.
Yeah, it's a flow.
I just want to look at a close-up of his left hand here, using the fingers, which this is where I think what you talked about in terms of gravity makes so much sense to me, because Morello and a lot of people who utilize fingers, especially in the traditional position, are motivating the stick with the finger. And it seems like...
But they don't play as much finger as they would like to think that they actually do, you know?
Well, it seems like Buddy is just, he it seems like it's just the opposite direction to me when he's with his left hand. Stick is just bouncing.
His whole hand is breathing.
His whole hand is breathing, and the stick is just bouncing. He's opening and closing it.
Well, he's not opening and closing. He's getting out of the way of what it is that occurs on the surface of the head, and that's doing it. And if he were to obstruct it, then he wouldn't have the audible sound at the other end. That end is doing what it does, and in order for it to play out, he's got to get out of the way.
But that interesting you say that, because I think that's what I'm seeing. This it is right there. It's absolutely just bouncing.
And not only that,
it's bouncing as much as if I were just to let go of it, and it's doing that. It's just totally.
Not only that, there's a minnow. It's not just up down, up down. If you watch his hand, you'll see there's a small...
No question.
You know, everything works.
There's the arc you're talking about.
The circles. He's not breaking any of the rules of how all bodies work from a planet to a human hand or anything. Motion. I mean, does it work? Or are you in the way? You know, collision. A collision.
How did you come up with all those series of exercises? Was it just honing down your teaching through the years? When you used to teach back in the early days, to look through these books and look through pages of exercises that systematically would get you from dead stick exercises to open and closing, to open up, close down, open down, close up.
Nobody ever seemed to be able to go directly to go and collect 200 because the stick would fall out of their hand. So you had to really, you know, you knew that there was attached to his shoulder. They could do that. It was them. So, you know, you had to start at A and then house the stick until finally you work toward doing what it is, the way it works normally, but allowing this to occur within the confines of that. And the two had to marry each other. So they work in tandem.